So the next kind of coverage I want to talk about is boundary value coverage. Boundary value coverage, unlike some of the other coverage metrics we looked at, doesn't have an especially tight technical definition. People use it to mean different things. We're going to look at it in a broad sense. What boundary value coverage basically says is, when our program depends on some numerical range, and when the program has different behaviors based on numbers within that range, then we should test numbers close to the boundary. So let's take the example where we're writing a program to determine whether somebody who lives in the USA is permitted to drink alcohol. So what we want is, if they're 21 years of age or more, it's fine for them to drink alcohol. And if they are less than 21, that is to say 20 or less, then it is not legal for them to drink alcohol. If we wanted to get boundary value coverage on this program, we'd want to include the ages of 20 and 21 in our test input, and possibly also 19 and 22, since they're close enough to the boundary values that there may be interesting behaviors lurking there as well. The insight here is that one of the most common kinds of errors that we make while creating software is off-by-one errors. Off-by-one errors can almost always be triggered by a value at the boundary, and so that's what we're trying to do here. What I've done here is framed boundary value coverage as a function of only one variable, and also I framed it in terms of the program specification, not in terms of the implementation. So let's look at those two issues in turn. So let's consider a program with two inputs. Let's assume for the sake of argument that these inputs are treated independently by the software that we're running. So the first input is going to be the age of your car. And we're an insurance company here, and we're going to decline to insure cars more than 20 years old. The other parameter is the age of the driver. And here we're going to decline to insure drivers who are less than 18 years old. If the software treats these values independently, we're probably okay testing values around 18 independently of the age of the car, and testing car ages around 20 years old independently of the age of the driver. So now on the other hand, if we had specific knowledge that our implementation considered these variables together, then we probably would also need to test with combinations of inputs that are near the boundaries. And you can see the problem here is that, of course, as the number of inputs to the program goes up, the number of test cases can grow very large because we have to consider the interaction between all possible combinations of variables that are dependent. On the other hand, if our variables are independent, then we can test them separately. So now let's briefly revisit the issue of whether we're doing boundary value coverage with respect to the requirements or the specification for a piece of software, or whether we're doing it with respect to the implementation. Okay, so let's go and revisit the program we looked at a little bit earlier, where I inserted a bug into our stats function, which caused it to misbehave for some inputs and not for others. So if you recall, we have the function here, stats, which computes the minimum, the maximum, median, and the mode of a list of numbers. And the problem I posed to you in a quiz was to break this function in such a way that a collection of test cases getting good coverage on it wouldn't discover the bug. And so the way I accomplished this was by taking the absolute value of the inputs. And so here's a bug that we've introduced that's only going to be discoverable when we pass numbers into the function which contain negative values. So if we think about what it takes to get boundary value coverage on a function like this, and now we're talking about boundary value coverage considering the implementation, not just the specification, what would happen is a function like absolute value would change its behavior around zero. And so what we would need to do to get boundary value coverage of the absolute value function is call it with a negative argument and a positive argument. So to get good boundary value coverage on this function, we would have been forced to call it with a list containing at least one negative number, and we most likely, in that case, would have discovered the bug. Let's look at this function in its broader context. We have a lot of code here. For example, I is less than min, I is greater than max. We have a lot of different operators in here that all have different behaviors around certain boundaries. And so to get good boundary value coverage on this function overall would be probably extremely difficult. I don't know of good tools automating this in Python. There are techniques such as mutation testing that can automate boundary value coverage, at least in some forms, in general.